freedom of movement. Well, that's what you're promising, Will, with a product that well, let's look at this thing. It's a hub motor, right? But it's more than a hub motor.
Way more than a hub motor. So if you look at what we can do here, it's not only the ability for this motor to spin the rotor, but we have the ability for it to go up and go down, to be able to sense the road itself, and to be able to adjust to the road conditions to create an ultra smooth ride, but at the same time, a safe ride. Because if you want to be able to have that agility with not only traction control, but roll control, yaw control, pitch control, to give you that ultimate freedom to move each corner independently to provide a safer and more comfortable ride. But more important than that, not just a safe and comfortable ride, but we can create a whole new class of vehicles that have more room inside and to be able to have a lighter vehicle where you can make a smaller outside, but a roomier inside, with each corner having the agility of that smooth propulsion and suspension built into each corner for no additional cost. Now, I've been involved with active suspension for a number of years. In fact, my old professor at MIT, Dr. Amar Bose, when I was studying there in 1999, he showed me the active suspension that he was working on for 2 decades.
Was that the Bose?
The Amar Bose.
That's incredible. And then let's talk about your background.
Did study at MIT and got a couple of master's degrees after I served as a nuclear submarine officer for almost 6 years. So when I went to MIT for graduate school, that was when I really discovered the passion for taking inventions and turning them into innovations and applying the market needs for what invention can actually do. So I've started a few companies. My previous 4 were all acquired by large publicly traded companies, including the last one being, you know, Samsung Pay. They acquired my company to become Samsung Pay.
Interesting.
And but my passion for the electrification started probably 13, 14 years ago.
And this is a huge component of electrification. And I want to talk about the car in a moment. But first, you know, why not just sell this as a component to other suppliers who are making cars?
Because we wanted to be able to actually show the application and fit first. Because most cars are designed in the old-fashioned way in a two-box design that's been around for almost 100 years. And that two-box design, it's much easier to just replace the engine with a motor, replace the gas tank with a battery. But for us, we're saying we don't need to have a frunk. We can really redesign the vehicle from the wheels up. And trying to convince somebody else to do it versus us seeing the demand and the need for us to do it is easier for us to actually take that leap and then show them to the point where it makes more sense for us to serve the customers and just go ahead and design it ourselves. So I'm going to show you the vehicle on what we did to build it from the wheels up.
Yeah, we're already seeing it in the mirror there. It's pretty cool. And let's take a look
and show you exactly what we've done here. So if you look at the wheels here, what we've done is put the robotic road sensing smart wheels right here out in front of each corner. That allows us to free up space between the wheel so that we don't need a big bonnet and we don't need a frunk. So we still have a crush zone over here for crash protection. But the driver can now have their heel point in between the wheels. So that means you can move the driver's seat up. And if you come a little closer, you'll see that we free up all of this usable cabin space for the passengers. And look at the leg room inside. I don't know if you can actually.
Yeah, there's a lot of glare here, but I saw it earlier. It's amazing, the space and the fact that you can configure the space to the purpose of whatever this thing needs to be.
Exactly. And the trunk space, because you have a low flat floor all the way to the bottom. You can see the trunk space is amazing. You have an axle in between. You don't have drive shafts. You don't have transmission. So everything is now built in to a much smaller platform and a smaller footprint, but more space inside. We have 110 cubic feet in this little space. Whereas a Toyota RAV4 is longer, it's bigger, but it only has 73 cubic feet of usable cabin space. And we're much smoother than any of the other EVs out there or any of the other conventional vehicles that are out there because of the active suspension and propulsion in each wheel.
And also is naturally four-wheel drive, right?
Naturally four-wheel drive in the snow, naturally better in road conditions, naturally able to stiffen up the suspension when you're trying to avoid another car and stay on the road without flipping over, because everything else basically has a big sprung mass on the top with little wheels. The contact patch is about the size of my palm,
mm-hmm.
and springs in between, and that's it. For us, we can actually stiffen the corners when we're swerving on one side so that, you know, we don't flip over and roll over, and we can create a much safer and a smoother ride.
And you've also simplified things in the sense that you do have the four wheels that are, you know, four hub wheels, but you're only steering in the front two. You're not trying to steer on all four and do crab walks and famous. Yeah. Yeah. The other feature, and I love your booth, because one of the things that really is kind of subtle is this idea of being able to put a different top on it. And you've illustrated that brilliantly here.
And now we can turn it into a cargo version. You can see here, we added, just come over here. You can see we added another 300 millimeters, and we can turn this into really a cargo version with 165 cubic feet of usable cabin space, and still the same center drive position, still the same platform with four robotic smart wheels.
Now, there's, you know, this is a great concept car, and I understand it. You know, it's been produced, your design produced for you. How are you going to bring this to manufacturing?
Great question. So for us, we're designers, we're inventors, but we have lots of folks, especially even in this building, that have been talking to us about having their excess capacity in their factories. They have factories, they have people, they have processes. They just need the demand. They need the demand of a vehicle like this that are there to serve not only the light commercial market, such as ride, hail, delivery. You got huge amount of demand for small compact vehicles that can be in cities, that can be much more efficient and smoother for not only the driver that sits there for 10 hours a day, but also more efficient with two sliding doors so that you're not opening up the door and clipping bicyclists or getting clipped yourself by traffic. And to have that comfort, safety, but also productivity. Now, packages, by the way, also could use a smoother ride, because nobody wants their grocery to show up with broken eggs and, you know, broken glass, right? So the ability to have a smooth ride, but a more efficient way to deliver those packages, and also on the other side, as you can see, deliver passengers with that level of comfort. Nobody else has actually done that before.
And that's, you're focusing on fleets, whether they be fleets for people or fleets for packages?
We had one of the largest transportation network companies in our booth. We were discussing, and they got a chance to look at our virtual reality and our design. They absolutely loved our solution. And, we have transportation fleets that are talking to us, large folks from a retailer standpoint that want our solution for their distribution. So yes, light commercial from both the large ones as well as the smaller ones. And when you think about the smaller ones, a lot of people don't realize that 91% of the fleets that are out there are small, medium-sized businesses.
That makes sense. Great for pizza delivery or whatever. So what do you see this as far as a volume price for it?
You see a 30,000 target price for our entry-level solution with that robotic smart wheels that are lighter, more efficient, faster to charge because it's a smaller battery. We don't need an 80, 100 kilowatt hour battery. Then you're just moving the battery back and forth rather than, you know, the people. Normally you're talking, you know, two or three people at most, including the driver. Vast majority of Uber rides are only one passenger, and 90% are two passengers. So why carry around all of that excess capacity? And does it make sense to deliver my Chipotle in a 4,000 pound SUV? Of course not.
Well, now you're making me hungry. But with that said, I do want to mention the path to autonomy, because this is all steer by wire, right? So why don't you talk to kind of the future?
So step one is to get these vehicles out for people to be able to drive them, and also which relates to passengers. So this is perfectly great for passenger vehicles as well. The next step is autonomy, and you see a lot of folks that are out here doing autonomy. We can leverage their technologies and the work that they're doing. And as we move forward, and the same customers, same transportation delivery network companies that are using these for their drivers today, they're also the same folks that want them for autonomy. So they're the same folks.
Yeah, it's great. Well, Will, I wish you luck. It's a great project. And oh my gosh, that motor is incredible. So
thank you so much.
Take care.
It's a pleasure.